the suffering and the pain of the masses of black people. No one wants to pay reparations. The Jews received over $100 billion in reparations and gets $4 billion annually. A Holocaust museum was set up for them on this soil for over $200 million, and they get $21 million annually just for operating expenses. But the Catholic Church, the Pope, the Jews, the Arabs, white people in general, no one wants to pay reparations to these, the sons and daughters of Africa. So I speak to them. I don't speak to the family of those two Jews. Too many. For me to speak to them.
May I ask you to just take a few moments of silence for Martin Luther King's mother, who passed 27 years ago. Yesterday,
Black power!
Black power!
Black power!
Black power!
Black power!
Black power!
The mother,
Christine,
Alberta Christine,
Williams,
who married a king. She did not depart.
Black power!
Black power!
Black power!
Black power!
Mungawa!
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 Black power!
Black power!
The land!
The land!
Black power!
Black power!
The land!
The land!
Black power!
Black power!
Produce your own food!
We make up your food!
Black power!
Black power!
Black power! Now that's black power! Black power!
Let me pivot for a moment, and then I'll come right here. Well, go right ahead. State your name.
My name is...
Please, everybody, don't make it. I mean, we know y'all got strong statements to make. But I'm not starting another panel out on the line, another one, because it'll go on all day.
Thank you for this conference. My name is Zaki Amir, and I'm from the Muhammad Speaks.
Yes.
I have two very quick questions. How would you describe the work of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad at the UN in the fight for reparations? And second, could you address the significance of the term Afro-descendant, its authorship, and what it means to 250 million former slaves throughout the African diaspora?
All right, that's a good question. I could answer that fast.
Yes, sir.
But effective. I would say that I respect the work that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who is the leader of the Lost Found Nation of Islam, and has been doing on behalf of reparations and our people since August 21st, 1977. I have nothing but respect for him, I love him, and I would hope that a part of these movement that we're going, that going forth as a part of this movement, that he would be his proper place.
Amen.
Because he's been a pioneer.
Yeah.
When I first heard Mr. Muhammad, in his Muhammad Speaks newspaper, who you represent, many years ago, stating that we're Afro-descendants, that hit my ear strange. But then when I went on international travels to meet our people in the Caribbean and South America, I get off the plane, I say, well, what do you all call yourselves? I'm in Colombia. They say, we're Afro-descendants, and so forth. So this is the accepted legal standard for our people in the Western Hemisphere is the term Afro-descendants. I mean, of course, we're black culturally, originally, even politically. We're black. Others don't go for the black term. They say, well, I'm a Moor. They say, well, it's 100 names out there. I'm an Israelite. Everybody wants to be everything, but we're talking about legal status here.
Yes.
And the legal status here, we've advanced to the point where Afro-descendant is the legal terminology, the name that we're using on the international forum.
Yes,
and so we have to thank Mr. Muhammad for his pioneering work. He thanked for pioneering. All right. Well, let me ask this quickly. Brother Tyler, and as young people, look like I saw some students come in here. And I want to ask you as a young person, why would reparations interest, how do we get young people to accept and be involved in the reparations movement like they were in the civil rights and the Black Power movement?
Thank you. And first I want to say that this is my mentor. So just want to shout him out.
Black power.
With regards to that, getting the youth involved, I think that we have to just make it in a way in which we can feel like we want to participate. Oftentimes, there's a big divide between the elders and the youth as it relates to some of the things that we need to do as far as building in community. And I think that in order to get rid of those barriers, we have to have more conversation and more dialogue. We have to have, I know personally, going to law school and accruing all that debt, you know, having reparations presented in a way that could address the education issue.
Come on.
And talk up and set up institutions. And then also, to Bible's point beside me, because majority of us are working class people, then having the institutions set up in place to where we can have jobs, because a lot of youth are unemployed, so don't have jobs. And providing different types of training and things of the kind. So for us, I think Dr. Khalid Muhammad said, you know, we're entertaining type of people, but also you have to deliver it in a way that's informational as well. You know, so being able to present it to us in a way that we can participate, that it will affect that we can actually see it, like the day-to-day, something thereafter. And then also just having us in certain positions so that we can feel like we're important. Because a lot of times we don't feel like we're being heard.
That's right.
All right. All right. We also have Morehouse. We have a couple of other colleges in here. Where are you from?
My name is Baba Peter Joins. I represent Harold Hunter and Peter Joins Facts Incorporated.
Okay.
And we've done work with you at Howard University when we had to take over university.
Okay.
And right now I have students here in the Summer Youth Employment Program. This is part of their curriculum and their learning, and they have several questions that they want to ask about the reparations movement.
I'm going to come right to you all. You all, let's give the students a hand. This program is a part of National Reparations Day, and I'm happy to say that there are activities going on in several cities right now.
Amen.
They're shutting down the Walmart in Denver. And that's courtesy to the new Black Panther Party.
Amen.
They're having educational forums and seminars for this National Reparations Day number one. The second one will be October 16th of 2019. We're trying to get going here in terms of this part of the movement. All right, let's go further here. We're going to work our other panelists into the conversation. Here's our great historian,
yes,
walking lexicon. Mm-hmm. Bob Oduno here, Washington, D.C.,
yes,
our teacher.
First and foremost, giving honor to Almighty God of all the worlds, giving honor to our noble ancestors, giving honor to our senior elders, those who are in the type as I am, a junior elder, and those who are under those elders. If it's okay, August body, I would like to stop here and defer to the questions of the young people. And I am not being gracious, it's because I'm a teacher. And we need to hear from our young people now.
Based on our elders' request, we'll take one question from the student section. We'll take a first question from the student section.
quick. Kathy want to ask a question.
If you can come up to the mic, it would be great. Come up to the mic so we can hear you. Don't be afraid. Come on up.
Yes, you can do it.
Hey, right. Come on, young lady. State your question loudly so we can hear it, please.
Question that we had was, what can the youth do to stop slavery?
What can the youth do to stop slavery? What slavery are you talking about?
Drugs. You say, what can the youth do to stop
ECO
slavery?
Okay, you young, what slavery are you talking about? You talking about then, now? Talking about the effects of slavery?
Yeah.
You know I'm just sharpening you up to it.
Yeah.
How old are you?
14.
You're 14? You're a year older than my daughter. Young lady, let me ask you, I think you could help me answer this question even better. Some of the things that you see in your generation, you may not know it or not, but they are the effects of slavery.
Yes.
When you see the hatred, when you see the violence, when you see the N-word, the nigger word, being treated routinely as a part of your daily existence, these are some of the vestiges of slavery.
Right.
When you see us in a bad economic way, and in a bad way in general, in some parts of our community, certainly not all, these are some of the effects of slavery. So let me flip it on you. Let me ask you, now how do you think that young people could stop some of these activities that we know that they are tied to the hatred and discrimination against our people in slavery? How would you suggest that we could help young people to try to get over some of those activities which are tied to slavery?
I think that everybody just need to play their part.
Okay.
All right. Black power.
All right. You ever watch videos of the civil rights movement? You ever seen some of them young people taking on water hoses? You ever seen some of them people just out in the street overturning society? You ever seen student walkouts? You ever seen whole schools worth of students just walk out of school?
I've been a part of it.
You've been a part of it?
All right, all right.
There was a National Reparations Day too, and we asked all the students to take a stand for reparations and to take a stand for repairing ourselves of the damage of what we've been doing to ourselves, and we would walk out on a student walkout day. Is that something you would participate in? You would take a stand for that? We want you to stick around.
All right,
let's do this. Dr. Jeffries, you got in trouble, and stays in trouble, but he got in big trouble in the early 90s, pointing out the financial origins of parties and defendants to our enslavement. You touched landmines at that time, and from your academic position, a chair of the City University of New York, right? City University, City College of New York, chairman of Black Studies Department. He was viciously attacked by the mayor of New York.
That's right.
And key forces. Some of his speeches, I went back and reviewed them. I mean, he was demonstrators everywhere. As many demonstrators as you've ever seen demonstrating on Minister Louis Farrakhan, they were on Dr. Jeffries. My question here, Dr. Jeffries, is the origin of the origin of our financial suffering, those that have profited from our enslavement and our suffering. How should we deal with it? I mean, should we ramp up your previous efforts of identification? Are we in an identification phase, or should we even be going further in terms of those that have robbed us?
Well,
Excuse me, sister.
Well, you can come take this. You want to take this if you can.
Yeah, but if I do, I may take it over. Well, certainly, I want to thank all of you for joining our brother and his team in coming together at this historical moment. This is in addition to a whole lot of other things going on. I just spent the past week in Detroit with the Ancobra celebration. And of course, Mr. Farrakhan made a very strong statement, but also there was a celebration of a brother who had been a part of the Detroit community, but he left Detroit, went down to Jackson, Mississippi to be with Chukwe Lumumba. So we had not only the live activity, but we were paying respect to those who have given their life to the struggle. So that Lake Zulu has asked me to come up to deal with this question of the financing of enslavement and who profited. And that's something we need to have serious studies on. What we were dealing with was real, because most people don't realize that I didn't get started in this thing yesterday. I'm 82 and I ain't through. And so when we're talking about enslavement and the system of enslavement, it became an international phenomenon. Whole wars were fought before, whole nations were involved. So if we just want to talk about Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, we're going to be stuck in a hole. You have to see, go to the coast of West Africa, for example, and you'll see all along the coast of West Africa, from Gombe in Senegal, or even above Senegal and Saint-Louis, the basis for enslavement, the slave dungeons and fortifications. And all of the nations of Europe were involved, even those that you don't think could possibly be involved. The Danes certainly were involved. Yes, they were. They formed the Danish company in about 1637. The Dutch couldn't possibly involve. The little tulip-growing, wood-shoe-wearing, windmill-pushing Dutch could not. They were some of the worst enslavers. And so the Dutch West Indian Company was formed in 1621. And then the Swedes did not want to get left out. Now you talk about the Scandinavians that ain't supposed to be involved. The Swedes formed the Swedish African Company in 1649. And you have to see this linkage, this money, this wealth creation. And so all the groups were involved. Some people said we couldn't have been involved, we was oppressed. That was one of the big stories that got us in trouble, because we mentioned people who have used their oppression in order to get their reparations, but don't want to talk about the collaboration with the oppressor. And then you can't hide from that. I have 50-something books, 53 books on the Jewish involvement in slavery. And 27 of them were written by Jews themselves. So I wasn't hesitant on raising who was involved. If I could put Queen Elizabeth I in 1569 when she was hooked up with it, if I can put the Pope in 1493 when he divided up the world and gave one half of it to one Catholic nation called Spain and another half of it to another called Portugal. You have to be able to put the goods right at the foot of whoever was involved. And you just can't say Africans sold Africans. You're talking about a four-way process.
Ministries from God, Church of God in Christ, also in Maryland. What do you say about the Black Christian involvement, the Black Church involvement, the Black Christian perspective on this struggle for reparations? Do you have a comment on this? This is Pastor Ted Sutton of People Can Change Ministries in Baltimore.
Well, first, I must say, it's nothing but God that allowed me to be here on today. Amen. And this is what we're going to have to come back to. There's one God. And see, I know that I come from a lineage where my father was an organizer with Dr. King, My mother worked for Megan Evers the same summer he was assassinated. But being that middle child that got caught up, I ended up having the opportunity to hang and be with one of the roughest groups that came out of Baltimore, but then before I seen the light. And see, and that's why I feel that, I've said it before, that it's impossible to be a Christian and a coward at the same exact time. Either you gonna be a real coward and a fake Christian, or you gonna be a real Christian and a fake coward. But you can't be, it's like matter and antimatter. It can't occupy the same space. And say, I say that because I look at myself, and so we're gonna have to break down some of the barriers. We're gonna have to, because we've had some culture vultures, and we've had some what I've called poverty pimps, who have actually used their platforms and in a way that wasn't beneficial to our communities. And so what we're gonna have to do is actually get back to the rights and the real of what's, and it says real, recognize real, but actually real, recognize everything. And I say that because being known as Dr. Ted Sutton now, but also if anybody ever Googled Crazy Ted, my face would come up. So I was that person that you didn't want to see at the wrong time. My godfather was a man named Little Melvin Williams, the man from American Gangster, and I, a lot of people knew me as known as Crazy Ted, but I had a chance. See, the bad thing is, it's bad to not be blessed, but it's worse to be blessed and not know that you're blessed.
Yeah.
So I had the opportunity to just see another side. So I'm still gangster. I just changed sides. So what we're gonna have to do is break down these walls that has tried to divide us as a people. Meaning when I say that, meaning that you know what, I don't, the Bloods, the Crips, the BGF, all of the brothers, we need these brothers too.
That's right.
And so we can't get so conscious that we wear the dashiki and say, oh, my brother, and then we look down at the brother that has his pants hanging down and the gold teeth and everything else, because those are some of the same brothers, and if you ever get them changed, they'll go some places that other church members will never go. So I look at myself in that same position, so when I see that, I have to also pray for some of my brothers, because I feel that some of them have lost some of their hope and some of their faith. And we have to let them know that your real strength comes in your faith.
Yes, sir.
And so to me, when I used to leave out the house when I was a teenager, they would say, do you have your gun? And I'd be like, it's like my credit card. Never leave home without it. But I see now that knowing what to fight and die for changes the way that you see life and how you see things now. So now I'm not worrying about no police officer pulling behind me. I'm not worrying about seeing my brother who I know is strapped, because I can see the little bulge here. I know predators because I was a predator. But see, the thing is that it's gonna take us to be bridge makers.
Mm-hmm.
See, you're gonna have to have Lil Boo and Lil Day Day and Lil Black, and you're gonna have to have somebody to come and get him because he's closer to the streets. Mm-hmm. And then you're gonna have to have somebody to get him closer to me. And then I'm gonna have to get somebody that gets him closer to brother. And then I'm gonna have to have, and then he's gonna have to have somebody that gets him closer to my brother. So we, it's like Meek Mill says, it's levels to this thing. So when I said that, I've always said, how can you expect for people to run the same race, but you start the starting gun for some people after the other people had already done two laps, and then you expect for them to have the opportunity to finish the race at the same time?
That's good.
So, I mean, and also on the other side, I mean, people talk about, well, I'm not voting for nobody until I have somebody to vote for. And I said, well, not me. I'm going to do something different. I said, even if I don't have somebody to vote for, I'm going to use my vote to vote against somebody. You better use your vote to vote against somebody. You may not have nobody that you like in this race, but you better make sure you know who you don't want in this race. And so I'm sharing that because I say that we need each other.
Yes.
Because we can't do anything until we get on the same page to just agree that it's one thing that we're gonna fight for.
That's it.
So I say that, and because I have always felt
that education and healthcare should be something that we didn't have to pay for. That was off the muscle. Because see, when you start talking about just checks, you know somebody gonna have a problem with it. You already know that. And also somebody else is gonna get that Cadillac. But I tell you one thing, the way that you change is that you change. And then you get the next person to change. But it's gonna come through teaching, but you can't teach them until you connect with them, and you can't connect with them until you learn to love
them. Come on. My question, I'd like to compare reparations from 1865. When we talk about repair, we're basically talking about, it was measured at that time in institutional ownership and control and property ownership and control. I'm speaking with the Freedmen's Bureau Act. So when you want to talk about legislation, we're right on top of the, the archives where these records exist. Now these were war records that were in place because blacks at that time had determined that in those southern states that what they had been building and what they had been working for was now theirs. So when you talk about economic sanctions, you're basically talking about they just decided they weren't going to work for them anymore. They said, we're doing all the work. We're not going to do anything. I built this house. It's mine. So there was a lot of confusion going on in those southern states. And that's basically what caused the southern states to lose control of the blacks at that time. So the North said, well, we gotta do something about that. And I'm not trying to take a long time, but I'm trying to draw a comparison, because the same thinking that was available to us then is available to us now. And the same thinking that they had to keep us in slavery, that's why the sister said, what can I do to end slavery? Because in her mind, hey, guess what? We're still enslaved. Okay, so I just want to just make that point, because it may have sounded like her question was ridiculous, but it's not ridiculous, because in her mind, what she's seeing is slaves. Okay, so we're still in slavery. So my point, the point that I'm making is that what was the mindset of them to determine to give us the Freedmen's Bureau Act? There was rebellions going on. They needed our labor. They need our labor today. So those companies that you just railed off, that's the Prison Corporation of America, there are 100 more and increasing every day.
What's your question?
So, okay, let me just formulate my question. To go to what Donald Temple said about the institution, because if you read the speech, the farewell speech of George Henry White in 1901, he measured what reparations looked like in the form of institutional ownership, which is businesses, which is schools, which is churches. You had the AME church. They were a big part of our freedom at that time. So I guess the question that I'm just trying to get people, it's more of a focus on what is it going to take to get us to look at reparations in the form of institution.
All right.
What is it going to get us to call? And I also want to bring up real very quickly the Honorable Minister Farrakhan. You can't talk seriously about any kind of revolution without dealing with him, because they're scared to death of him. And we're scared to death to mention his name sometimes too.
That's right.
So when we play that game, we know right now we get nothing, because he controls the army. He can call 100,000 or 200,000 to tomorrow right now, men that will kill and die for him. So we're all following his pattern. Let's get that clear right now. There's nothing that's being said in this room today that hasn't been said by the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan for the past 40 years. So we following in his footsteps, and right now he's the point man, as far as I'm concerned.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for that statement. Okay, let me ask this question here. I want to ask this to Kenneth Henry, Sister Queen Kenneth Henry. I got your name right?
You do.
From M. Cobra. And another reparations activist here, brother, Mr. John Cheeks of the American Recovery Act. We'll come to this question. I'm gonna ask you here. I really want to be. Can I challenge you gently? Can I gently challenge?
I don't know about that.
Okay. The legislation, because I know you're not responsible for H.R. 40, right? There are critics, according to what we read, that are saying of H.R. 40 that say a study is not enough. And from what I know, INCOBRA is encouraging us to go well beyond study. Could you tell us, the audience here, what the National Coalition of Black for Reparations in America, what your current position is on H.R. 40, is it strong enough, and where, and what are you proposing as the future path from INCOBRA perspective? Wherever you desire, man, whatever makes you most comfortable. Let's give her a hand, please.
First of all, Black Power. Black Power. Black Power.
Black Power. Black Power.
I bring you greetings from INCOBRA. There are a couple of things I do need to make some corrections on. First of all, the original H.R. 40 was a study bill. That is correct. In 2016, it was very obvious that the harm against our people, the violence, etc., has been studied, restudied, and studied some more. Many, many scholars have written on it, so there is no need to continue to lobby for a study bill. And the bill was revised, and in 2017, with the 115th session of Congress, it became a remedy bill. So what we're asking for is to stand up a commission that will craft remedies that will address the multifaceted harms that have been perpetrated against the people, that's us. So it is no longer a study bill. It was rewritten and introduced in 2017 as a full remedy, full repair bill.
Okay, so let me ask, okay, thank you for the clarification. Let me ask another follow-up question to that. How do you respond to the critics of a approach for reparations through the U.S. Congress that states that this majority white body of the Senate and Nancy Pelosi are never going to really cooperate with reparations and give us full and complete reparations? How do you answer that charge that's coming from certain quarters?
I think you've already answered it. It's by any means necessary.
Yes.
So we do start by playing inside the rules of this is where we get started with the legislation. However, if necessary, then it has to be by any means necessary. So my charge when I came here was to talk about education and what INCOBRA is doing. So one of the other things that I need to correct, or at least try and get clarification on, and I think the brother left already, is his H.R. 41, 42, 43, 44, 45. You hear? Oh, thank you so much, sir. Are those bills already introduced, or is this something that you plan to introduce somewhere down the road?
I'm planning to introduce them within the next 30 days. It's going to be, and Cobra's going to get a copy, Sheila Jackson Lee is going to get a copy, and we'll get a copy because it's going to be a draft for us to have a triggering mechanism for H.R. 40.
Okay, so just so we're all on the same page, there is already a H.R. 41, 42, 43, 44, 45 already out there. So, and I don't want anyone to walk away thinking that we're looking for those particular bills. They've already been introduced and they're out there. So to answer your question, sir, about what do we do? How do we tell people about reparations and who's for it and who's not for it? Right now, we have more co-sponsors on H.R. 40 than has ever been the case. For whatever reason, we all know that it's probably because we have candidates running for president or whatever.
Explain to them what you mean by co-sponsors. To them.
Okay. All right. Thank you. A co-sponsor is an elected official who comes on board and says, I support that legislation. So
how many do we have? How many do you have now?
As of today, we have 90 co-sponsors for HR 40 on the House side. And we are not, we are excited, but we're not excited. You have 435 members in the House. So our charge is to continue. We actually rolled out a campaign where we are going to approach all 535 elected officials. That's the 100 senators on the Senate side and the 435 members of the House side. And our purpose is to ask for their support as a co-sponsor for HR 40 in the companion bill, which is S.1083 on the Senate side. On the Senate side, in the 2 months that it's been out there, we actually have 14 co-sponsors on the Senate side. And while these numbers may sound abysmal, they aren't, because never in the history of the push for reparations has there ever been that many co-sponsors. So this is progress, and it's progress that has been done by a very, very, very few people. So as we talk about collaborative efforts, as we talk about coming together on a united front, and of course, I believe that I can't fly without you. You all must become the wind beneath my wings. Mm-hmm. So collaboratively speaking, and not just this small group here, but we have to fan out all across this country and become a united force and send a message, as you said, sir, the message that this is quid pro quo. We are not giving anything if we're not gonna get anything. And what we want is full support for the legislation that's in the House and the Senate.
All right, and Cobra, speaking to us. And so before I turn it to Mr. Dashaun Farad, I want to go on record with every other organizer, every other group, every legal group, every reparations group in America or anywhere out there. We want to go on record that we are for, as I said before, for a common front. Our doors are open. Our phone lines are open. Our dialogue is here to be engaged in. We're at black-empowerment.com. We recognize there are many out there fighting for reparations.
Yes.
And we say we need to be fighting together.
Yes.
We are pushing for what we call an interim government.
Yes, sir. Yes,
we're
sir.
Talking about, as leaders, a process of government where we sit down and decide how we're going to make the legislative progress that Incobra and others have made, how we can make that go further, how we can address things that we may disagree on so we don't look all over the map in the public. We don't want just a lot of mess out here, people talking reparations, because you got the people's hope up. Mm-hmm. You get the people's hope up and the leadership doesn't handle it right, then we end up in another mess.
Come on.
So we want to be clear that we're just a part of the process. We recognize the other groups, the organizers that are organizing, and whether they call us or not, we're making a public statement here now that we're willing to sit down at the table as equals. And let's negotiate how we put our power together, our forces together. Because there's some power here. In a few, at 5 o'clock, we're gonna be at the doorstep of the home of Senator Mitch McConnell, who opposes reparations. At 5 o'clock, you will see, this is Imam Akbar here, the chief of staff of the new Black Panther Party, the great Imam Akbar. Soon, in dinner time, you will see the kind of pressure that we can apply.
Yes, sir.
There are unique forces here that are here right now that can make unique things happen at unique times.
Amen.
And that's why we have the new Black Panther Party. We have to have some enforcement out here on the streets.
That's right.
We can't allow this fraud. Hold on, let me. I was gonna say he was a frog face looking, but I'm not gonna, because that wouldn't be so professional of me. So I won't say that he looks like a frog. I won't go into that. Mitch McConnell has offended us. He's attacked our position.
That's right. Daniel.
And damn it, he lives on 617 C Street Northeast. Yes. He lives on 617 C Street Northeast. That's where he lives. And that's where we're going to be.
Yes.
For our reparations hearing and our First Amendment speak out at 5 o'clock. We're going to be right on the devil's front door.
Yes, sir.
And that's the beginning of what we call revolutionary confrontational politics. I don't mind to say that we're looking for a fight.
Come on.
We're looking for a legal fight, an organizational fight, and a political fight. We're looking for a fight. How are you going to become a champion and win a fight if you don't look for a fight and challenge whoever's in front of you? Let me be cool for a minute. 617 C Street, everybody online, everybody, you can still got a chance. Northeast DC, we're going to be deeper than this, than we're here right on his doorstep. And that in and of itself is going to be historic. Because nobody has confronted a U.S. official on his front lawn for damn near nothing, let alone reparations. I took the risk of finding all this info out, setting it up, and helping us get there. All of that risk. Because trust me, when you're planning something to act like that out, it's some risk.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if I take all that risk, don't leave me hanging.
No, sir.
We're going to see you at 5 o'clock, man. They want to send a shockwave out here. All right. Farrah. Come on. Dashaun Farrah. Let's give Donald Temple a hand. Coming to you next, attorney.
Family, peace. Listen, in the interest of time, I'm not going to give a whole diatribe. I'm Dashaun Farrah, journalist, work with Dr. Boyce Watkins and several others, et cetera, et cetera. We're going to get this panel moving along, and I'm going to go to the next panelist. After I go to him, I'm going to go to the questions. But I must say ahead of time, family, in the interest of time, when we tell you to ask your question, we don't want to hear Michael Eric Dyson. Just ask your question and be gone, et cetera, et cetera. With all due respect, in the interest of time, we understand we all have a lot to say, but keep in mind, as people of African descent, we teach in a circle. This question is going to go to, first of all, I want to introduce the chairman of the DC Recovery Act, Mr. John Cheeks. Please give him a round of applause. Mr. Cheeks, and I have the privilege of working with him. Why, after all this time, does it seem that the reparations movement, some would say, is ineffective? What has been our mistake in getting our money?
Good afternoon, people.
Good afternoon, brother.
The reparations movement has caused division because of white America knows what the definition legally of reparations is in this country. Mm-hmm. Reparations means that any criminal who committed an act against the people of the country should be criminally prosecuted. We should take military actions after international governments who participated in the act. So that's why when you say reparations to a white American, they freeze up. Notice that. Go up to them and say, I want reparations. They're gonna look at you in fright and run because it's going to criminally prosecute them, period. And is going to take money and wealth from them. What we developed in the District of Columbia is called recovery. See, we started the Recovery Act in the District of Columbia in 2016 with the Honorable Malik Zulu Shabazz, attorney.
That's right.
Other Nation of Islam members through public radio Afro-American commentators who invited us to speak on it. And the DC Recovery Act is now alive. DC Recovery Act started the discussion of reparations. That's right. Why you see your congressmen, your senators, and all of them talking about it. We started it here in the district, and it's so important to end it here in the district because of our federal position. We get the DC Recovery Act going here first. The rest of the nation is a piece of cake.
That's right.
Because they have to follow federal precedents. Now, have I met with some of the actors that the Honorable Malik Zulu has said? Yes, it's 83 of them. And out of the 83, some of them have 100 to 200 affiliates. And they are fully financially healthy. They offered me about $14 billion in the district, not to be recognized, but they want to start the payouts this year. We're gonna vote on it, and if our vote doesn't work, or the system, I should say, turns our vote into a no-show, we're gonna do what's called self-help and do a private corporation so that we can receive our benefits. The actors are ready to pay. They're not at all disputing. They're not at all. Now, since Congress ended, I should say the June 19th discussion on when black people were actually injured, when the ending determination of injury, which is the hanging, the lynching. So that means that our injury has stopped this year. That's $78 trillion. Not $14 trillion, not $28 trillion. That's $78 trillion. Now the actors have the money. They have it over a 30-year cycle. It's not a hard amount of money for them to reach and to pay. We just all have to stay together the way that we are and move forward. Reparations is here for all of us to take advantage of. And if a brother goes out and get him a Cadillac or a Lincoln, he's going to help the economy. He's going to help it. The brother is also entitled to $650,000 at the age of 55. But you must own a home. So if you don't own a home, we're going to give you a voucher. You go out and buy a condo or a house for $300,000 and get the rest in cash and call it a day with your Cadillac in your driveway, okay?
Okay, we're going to get back to the audience. Who's our sister here?
Yes, ma'am.
Comment and question real quick.
And we know you'll be brief.
Yes.
As Donahue used to say.
Yes. My great-grandfather on my father's side, his father, his name was Josh Horn. He was a slave. His other great-grandfather was Antonio Franklin. Antonio Franklin was born in Chihuahua, Mexico. I'm a member of Cherokee, Blackfeet, and Lulac. And the one thing that I have to disagree on is that when Native Americans and indigenous people and Latinos get together, they do not vote for anyone that does not support their positions. And as a member of Lulac, I dissent because I'm a black woman first. So when they grant on someone that's one of the immigrants, they vote only for those politicians. Like today, they're down there looking at the camps. My question, why aren't you looking at the people in Washington, D.C., the missing girls with their organs missing?
So my
question is, how are we all going to get together? Who's going to take the charge? Because I notice there's some groups that are missing, and I know that they're out there, and I know that Rob, I agree with you on economic dispute, 100%. But I also agree that I know that you're waiting for them to contact you, and sometimes we should not wait. What I'm asking is, would you all please, someone take the lead to consider looking at all the groups that are still out there working for the same thing and contacting them so that we can get together. That's the only thing.
Everybody here, especially those that are working close, Dr. Ansari and myself, every day, it's a continuous call for a united front. Reach out, make contact, see what every other group is willing to do. We don't have any problem reaching out. We've reached out to many groups, they haven't reached back.
That's right.
But we'll continue to reach out to everybody. again, because we know that it's going to take more than this. But we're willing to roll with this. Nobody wants to work with us.
Yes, sir.
All right, so let me, yes, ma'am, please.
Thank you so much. Also, in COBRA is always reaching out. As a matter of fact, in a couple of minutes, one of my peers is on her way to be a part of a panel discussion, and it is a collaborative effort with the Union for Reform of Judaism and the Central Conference of American Rabbis. So we are out there. We have petitions out front. We invite you to go out to sign one or both of them that you're comfortable with. One is asking for you to support full reparations, and the other is asking you to indicate your support for the legislation that's in the House. On Saturday, we were in Baltimore.
Let me ask this, outside of that, what would be the role of our, because my position is we're all African. I want to be clear on my position.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I ain't no American. Some folks around saying I'm American this, American, I ain't American, none of that. To me, that's no disrespect, but that's a backwards political terminology. To label yourself as American anything. So my position is that we are all an African people.
Come on.
We are all an African people. We have continental Africans, our brothers and sisters who live on the continent, and we are Africans of the diaspora.
Yes, come on.
But what is the role of the continental African? What is the role of this African Union in the reparations cause? Talk to us and let us welcome Jackie Johnson from Profile Africa. She's doing big things here in America to connect us with trade in Africa, but tell us about reparations. What do you all have to do with this?
Thank you very much. It's called us all here today. And I also want to give honor to King Shaka Zulu and the Zulu Royal House, even as we have one of his standard bearers here today in Malik Zulu Shabazz, the Honorable. Thank you very much for being here. And I want to give honor to the God that I serve, the great I am that I am, and the great elders here today, and Congresswoman Sheila Jackson Lee, who has been a forerunner, or one who has continued this plight in reparations. And I do want to put a caveat there just to say that she is one of the most declarated Africans / African Americans in Africa. She's received the highest honor from several presidents on the African continent, which would be equivalent to the honorable congressional honor here in the United States, or the one that is actually bestowed by the US president. So she's a very influential person on the continent. But my name is Jackie Johnson. I'm founder and CEO of Profile Africa Worldwide. We are a brand strategy, public relations, business development, media agency. And what we do is focus on exactly what our name is, Profile Africa Worldwide. Not just a name, but a mission. But I was in South Africa, which is where I straddle my time from here in the US. I was in South Africa on May 25th, which is Africa Day, 2012, when the African Union and the Pan-African Parliament declared the African diaspora, global African diaspora, as the sixth region of the continent of Africa. Many of us don't know that we are a part now of the entire African continent. And why did the African Union and Pan-African Parliament declare their diaspora a region now, officially, as a part of the continent? Because they want to build Africa together. They want to make sure that we have a part in Africa's growth story. Why? Because 7 out of 10 of the world's fastest growing economies are on the continent of Africa. So everybody else is there. Everybody else is there. The Chinaman is there. The French is there. All the Europeans are there. Russia's there. And when you talk about Russia and China, they're in a growth group with South Africa even, called BRICS. Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. So they are global economic partners. So when we want to talk about our reparations here, it's so that not only we can prosper here, but also prosper there. And when we say that Africa owes even us something here in the U.S., you're absolutely right. And that's why they've made us and reinstated us or put out a clarion call for us to return to the African continent.